गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन. अभी आर प्रोजेक्ट इज इम्प्रूविंग SBHS रिमोट ट्रिगर्ड वर्चुअल ऐप सर्वर एंड वेबसाइट. एंड इन माय टीम आई हैव देवकांत, दीप, रुपेश, राम, हु कुड नॉट बी हियर विद अस अनफॉर्चुनेटली, एंड आई एम श्रिया. सो दिस आर द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स विल बी कवरिंग थ्रू द कोर्स ऑफ आर प्रेजेंटेशंस: एडमिन फीचर्स, हेल्थ मॉनिटरिंग, बग फिक्सिंग, proposing another architecture with load sharing and scalability, testing both architectures and a few other random features. Now essentially single board virtual system labs is a laboratory which is used in instrumentation control labs. Now the three essential features of the single board heater system virtual labs is that the equipment itself is incredibly small and portable, which makes it handy for use and setup. Secondly, it's open source, which is a thing the entire program is trying to promote. And third and most importantly, it's remote triggered. Now what remote triggered means it overcomes the hindrances posed forth by the two alternatives: a physical laboratory where I actually have to be present to conduct the experiments, and b a pure simulation which can at best only model the real world and not represent it completely. Whereas in case of a remote triggered virtual laboratory, you have an experiment been conducted on a particular equipment and only the input and output are streamed to the user through web browsers. We'll present you a brief demonstration of how a user is supposed to conduct an experiment on our virtual labs. Now first he logs in through his already created account. As the user is logged in, he's already allotted an MIT, so he can book a slot on that particular board on which is allotted. As he books a slot, he can go into the directory where the files, user files are there in order to, which have the codes in order to run the client code. This is the client interface where he logs in again. And then he goes on to the Scilab and executes this file, which enables him to conduct the experiment. On executing this particular code, he can actually see the video. He sees the current board which he is allotted in order to figure out that the values returned to him are actually correct. He can also download the user logs which are being generated through his experiment. These are the logs which are generated when a user conducts an experiment.
So what we have incorporated in this project are some admin features which were not previously present. For example, the first one is a feature called, which includes making a board temporarily offline. Now, why was this needed? This was needed in case a board currently goes offline, but there are, suppose, some users who have been allocated that board, but the sensor is not working. So obviously, we must take it offline. But what temporarily offline means is it is as good as offline to a user, but it is online for an admin. So he can conduct tests on it, but the board will be shown as offline to the other users. And he can toggle the state when he's done testing. The second one is in test boards. Like, for example, there is an experiment ongoing right now. And the admin can actually monitor the experiment which is ongoing, the iteration, the heater, fan, and temperature values in real time. And for boards which are not ongoing, he can check the state of the boards, get the current temperature of the boards, set parameters, or reset them. And in case the admin wants to check the state of all the boards, he can click on Show All Images to see the state of all the boards simultaneously. Yeah, so all the online boards, currently online in the lab, live webcam feeds of them have been taken, and they are auto-refreshed every minute. The next feature which we have is the update MID. Now, some user has been allocated a board which suppose comes out to be faulty for some reason. Now, the user still has to conduct the experiment. So in that case, the admin can change the currently allocated MID to the one which is has currently bearing the least load. For example, in the below, we can check that which machine has what load currently. And he can allocate a machine to the user which has the least load. And the next one is fetching logs. This is just a feature to make it easier for the admin to, like the experiments which have been conducted before, he can fetch the log files of them based on a within a stipulated time period. Now we just gave today's date, so there's no results.
Okay. Good evening, all. Up next, the feature is health monitoring. The health monitoring means we are trying to monitor the condition of the boards that are being used. Previously, the health monitoring script that was there, it is only checking the connectivity, not about the status of the board. It was only checking that the board is connected or not. But currently, we have modified it. It not only checks the connectivity, but it also tries to analyze its sensor, its fan, and its heater are working or not. Like, means we are trying to send some specific values of heater and fan over a period of time and get the results of the temperature of the sensor that the sensor is getting and trying to analyze those values. We are expected to get a value like inverted V-shape. If it is not getting such a value, then there is some error and these boards are taken as temporary offline and a mail is being sent to the admin regarding these MID are having these probable problems.
Okay, this is a feature which we incorporated to automate the server maintenance and server setup as much as possible. Now, when the webcams are mounted onto a system, they are allocated a /dev/video path, which actually changes on reboot. So what we did was, we extracted some information about the device. For example, the kernel ID or the product ID. These values in the Linux kernel, they stay same even after reboot. So we wrote a script which extracts them and forcefully mounts them at specific dev paths so that even after reboot, we don't need to again manually set the boards. And one more problem which we encountered was, for example, we have designed a new architecture involving master slave architecture involving Raspberry Pis. Now, Raspberry Pis do not have an RTC or a real-time clock. So syncing the time with the master server was an issue. But there's an automated script which runs every hour to sync the time of all the Raspberry Pis with that of the master server. Yeah, and to set up the server code on the Raspberry Pi, all you have to do is just wget a script and run it, and it'll set up all the code dependencies, and it'll be ready for production.
So the existing architecture basically had a single server connected to a bunch of SBHS devices through USB hubs. Now there were two problems in the former scenario. A, USB hubs were unreliable, and B, if some error happened in the master server, the entire system collapsed. So we came up with a new architecture where you have a master-slave configuration. You have one master connected to a bunch of RPIs acting as slaves, which have a lower subdivision where there are SBHS devices connected. Now, how does it overcome the defects of the former architectures? A, it is load sharing. So the load is shared between the master and the slaves, and the master can no longer be overburdened. B, Raspberry Pis have turned out through experimentation to be more reliable than USB hubs. And C, it is scalable, that is the number of SBHS devices connected can be extended as we want to. And if one of the Raspberry Pi fails, only the SBHS devices connected to that particular Raspberry Pi, that particular slave fails, and not the entire system, not the entire master collapses.
Next, I'll be explaining how this master slave is working actually. This is the master server with a database and the Django server and an Apache gateway that is acting as a proxy gateway setup. And these are the RPIs acting as slave servers, and four SBHS boards have been connected to each of them. And these are the client, and all of these RPIs are connected through LAN, through a switch. So whenever all the requests that are regarding the SBHS, like setting a heat or getting the temperature or setting a fan value, those kind of requests are directly proxy passed to these RPIs without affecting the Django server in the master system. And all the UIs and the means like website things are being directed to the Django server. And we can simply infer that during the experiment, the master servers remains unloaded, and each RPI are handling four SBHS, so they also remain they prove to be quite reliable. The database is centralized in order to stop inconsistency of data. There is only one database, and each RPI is getting the data and storing in that one only. And for security purposes, what we have done is that other than master IP of the master system, no one can access these RPIs.
So I just have a very small thing. You're using RPI just to turn on and off your systems?
No, sir. It collects data, and actually they have in their vision that they want to replace this, means these are SBHS devices, and they want to use more complex devices in future where there will be some computations in the server end.
Server end.
ARPA is now acting as a DAC device, data acquisition devices.
Okay.
But in the future, the ARPA can also act as a node device, which can actually compute some stuff which is required to be done on the
okay.
server.
Okay.
So essentially, the master server just acts as a sharing task sharing machine, and the tasks are allocated to the
ARPA. Sharing, device. If I'm not wrong, if you want to just put a task sharing or anything like that, so turning on and off, you can use a simple Arduino also.
It is not turning on and off. It is means setting data. It is communicating with it, and also means log. Like the storing the log files and everything.
Storing the log files in the local.
Initially it is in local. In each 1 hour, a cron job pulls everything to the master server.
So why it is not sent directly to the master server?
Every time means every second one line will be created in the file. So it will be better to create the whole file, because one slot is for 1 hour. So one experiment will be conducted in 1 hour. So the whole log file will go to, because each time one line, it is maybe some miss of data will be there or something.
Okay.
So these were the bugs which cropped up during our project time. And the first was the zero temperature problem, where the board sometimes returned a zero temperature value, which we rectified by opening a new serial port in between the experiment. The second was a cannot connect to server message, which cropped up in the client app, which happened due to unhandled exceptions, which we obviously handled. The second was when an initial slot is allocated to an user, there was a foreign key mismatch between the tables of accounts and boards tables, which we rectified. And another bug which we rectified was the index out of range exception, which arose when we were allocating a board to the initial user and there were no other users online, so we handled that exception too. And what it essentially was doing is trying to access an empty list, which we rectified. Second, we corrected the order in which the booking should appear, that is in order of the most recent booking to the earliest booking that the user had done. And empty experiment log files, we removed the discrepancy that was created while downloading an empty log file. And we prevented the Arduino from, we discarded the result that Arduino used to send, which caused a false MID to be displayed.
Yeah, coming to the hardware developments in this project, in the SBHS setup, we have, on the client side, there's a Scilab script which runs, and on the background, there's a Python script which sends data, the heater and the fan values to the SBHS devices. Now the communication from the server to the SBHS devices occur over the USB channel. There was a problem with the SBHS board setup, where there was a and USB channel, there are 5 pins, power plus, power minus, data plus, data minus, and a shield pin. Now what happens if you don't connect the shield pin to the ground? The shield pin is not directly shorted to the ground. All the noise that is coming over the channel will be directly implemented on the data signals, corrupting the data signals, and the SBHS devices will go out of the order. So in the layout diagram of an Atmega 16 board, which is being used in the SBHS board, on the top right you can see the USB type B female acceptor connection board. The identified shield pin and the ground pins have been shorted together to avoid the problem. The problem that came earlier was there was a serial exception, and the SBHS devices would return no data while the data was being sent to the SBHS devices. Also, the another system that was implemented was an Arduino-based relay board controls. Arduino controls the relay boards, which switches off the devices when they were not in use. A script was written on the Arduino code, which accepts a string of command, let's say N01 or F01, which turns on and turns off the devices based on the logic that the next slot, if the next slot is empty, the device will be turned off.
Okay, so it was required that our code was pushed to production, because this would be used by the students of the institute in the upcoming semester. So before pushing the code to the code to production, we tested it for around 1 week, and we had a script which automatically books all the slots for all the devices and performs experiments parallelly on all the devices. Now this script ran on for around a week with intervals in between. And after that, almost every feature we did was tested through the scripts, and everything is automated so that with minimum admin intervention. And these are a few challenges that we faced. The code that we initially had was Django 1.6, which had a lot of third-party dependencies, including database interactions. It uses South for handling database interactions, so we upgraded the entire project to Django 1.11. And the next thing was there was no proper documentation. So
in order for future maintainers, we have written the developer documentation. The documentation for all the functions, methods, classes, whatever we have, has proper documentation, which is available on the VLab site. And the GitHub repos has readmes with all the setup instructions and the setup script as well. You can just run the setup script and the server will be up. Yeah, so what we learned here was web development following an MVC based framework, for example, Django. We learned how to configure Apache web servers configuration and bash scripting, yeah, because the current detecting the SBHS devices and the webcams, they were all kernel events when they were put in and out. So that was an effective learning experience. And yeah, we learned the importance of extensive testing before pushing anything to production.
So essentially, the most important thing which can come out of this is extending this entire system to new laboratories. This we created and set up the single board heater system virtual laboratory. The architecture that we gave is load shared and very reliable. So this can be extended onto other laboratories with minor changes in the server codes. Thank you.